I'm gonna make a video pretty soon on some very cool mods I like for Stalker Anomaly, so I figured let's update my modding guide before doing so. My last one is a bit outdated and could be better, to be honest. So if you want to get started with modding Stalker Anomaly, here we go. We're gonna start from scratch, so let's make a fresh install of Stalker Anomaly first. And as usual, every single link for the things I mentioned in this video will be in the description. And there's some extra troubleshooting stuff in there too, so make sure you check it out. So you should have two files so far you downloaded on ModDB, Anomaly and the latest update. So let's extract the two archives, we can do both at the same time, it's fine, and when it's done, we're gonna copy the content of the update folder inside the anomaly folder, and we're gonna replace the files when we are asked. Then we are gonna move the folder to the root of our drive. It's not mandatory, but can prevent some issues, and rename it to whatever you want, and then start the game. It's an important step, so don't miss it. And we can check if everything works so far at the same time. We can see that it's the 1.5.2 version, all good. Technically, if you want the vanilla anomaly experience, you're done, you can start playing right now. But hey, we're here to mod the game a little bit, so let's do this. A lot of more advanced mods today use the modded executables, so basically an improved patch version of the base game. This step is not absolutely mandatory, so technically you can skip it. Every mod that needs these new executables will tell you in their description. But personally, I like to add them with every fresh install I make, so I don't have to think about it anymore. Anything you see with DLTX, for example, needs them, but not only, there's a lot more too, so it's just easier to install them from the get-go. So we are gonna download them on the official page, and make sure that you have the C++ files installed first. Then you go there to download the files. When it's done, extract everything, and we're gonna copy the contents of the folder inside our anomaly folder. Replace the files when you're asked, and start the game again with the shader cache disabled. You only have to do this once, not every time you launch the game. And we can see that we have our game with the new executables working. All good, we can leave. Okay, and final step, we need to install Mod Organizer now. We are gonna create a new folder on the root of our drive for Mod Organizer next to our Anomaly folder. And then we're gonna copy the Mod Organizer executable inside the folder and launch it. Again, you will find all the links in the video description for it. Here, we are gonna make sure that we point towards the Mod Organizer folder we just created and just click Next for everything else to install everything. We're gonna launch Mod Organizer and pick Create New Instance. If you never used it before, you might have a slightly different start, but you're gonna end up here at some point anyway, it's all the same. I'm not gonna go into the debate of global versus portable instance, it's more for people who want to have different variants of the game installed at the same time. Is it better to have multiple portable instances or a global one with different mod profiles? To make sure we all have the same thing, let's choose portable instance. Here we are prompted to choose the game we want to use, so we are gonna select our anomaly folder where the game is installed. The next window will pop up automatically, make sure it's pointing to the folder we created for Mod Organizer. Then you can finish the install and Mod Organizer will launch. We are done, we can start modding now. You can try to start your game from Mod Organizer here if you want, just to make sure that everything is set up correctly. Okay, for me we're good, so let's get started. By the way, from now on, to start your game, you need to go to your Mod Organizer folder and launch Mod Organizer. Just create a shortcut for it. We do not use the base game executable anymore. Here, we get into the brunt of modding your game, and different things can happen. So let's go over the different possibilities so you know what to do in most cases. Let's start with an easy example when everything goes right. So let's say I want this very important add-on to add anime weapons to my game. First, and you should always do this, check the requirements and the installation instructions on the mod page. Here, you can see that you also need boomsticks and sharp sticks for this add-on to work. So let's download everything we need. To keep things simple, I'm gonna leave all the pathing by default. So we have the two mods we just downloaded. Let's move them into the download section in our mod organizer folder. No need to extract them, just move them here. In mod organizer, we are gonna select install new mod from an archive. If it doesn't bring you automatically to the downloads folder, go there and select boomstick and sharp sticks. You can edit the name of the mod if you want, and it's gonna install automatically. Another way is to simply right-click and pick install mod, and let's install our anime guns. When you start your game, Mod Organizer will load the mods in the order we put them in. It's very important to remember this. So first we're gonna turn them on, and we're gonna leave boomsticks and sharp sticks first in the list. So it loads first because it's the main mod. The anime guns are just adding texture on top of it, so it should be second. And from here, we can just start the game. I'm gonna turn on the debug mod so we can check that everything works. And now that we're in game, we can see that we have the boomstick and sharp sticks weapons. I'm gonna start saying bass instead of boomstick and sharp sticks because it's really hard to say. So we can see that we have our bass weapons and we have our anime weapons too. So perfect. Everything is working well so far. And the reason we use Mod Organizer and don't install mods manually is that you can turn on and off mods without damaging or compromising your game install. You can remove stuff you don't like and experiment with whatever you want without being destructive. Okay, now let's install something that comes with a faux mod, like Maid's Icons. A faux mod basically means that you're gonna have different options to choose when you install the mod. The process is exactly the same. We have our file, we move it to our downloads folder, we install the mod in Mod Organizer, and here we have the different options popping up. And here you need to start thinking. We have Bass already installed, and this mod added a ton of new weapons to the game. And now we want to add a mod that replaces all the icons of the game. So is it gonna work with all the new stuff we've just added? You can see how there could be a conflict here. In this case, Bass is very popular and Maids knows this, so it's not gonna be an issue here. It's even gonna give you extra options that works with Bass, but sometimes you will have to make sure that you enable compatibility options depending on the mods you already have installed. And sometimes, if there is no faux mod, you will have to read carefully the mod installation instruction on the ModDB page to see if there are compatibility patches and you have to install them manually. Here, everything is taken care of, we can just finish the installation and we can see in-game that everything worked, we have the new icons, perfect. It's actually something you should do every time you add a new mod, start your game and check if it's working. Do not add 15-20 mods at once and try. If there are any bugs or conflicts, it's gonna be much more complicated to identify where the issue comes from. And keep in mind that some mods require a new save, they will generally state it clearly in the description, so they won't work with older saves, so be careful before installing them. Let's install Weapon Cover Tilt, for example. Another easy install. We have Bass, so we make sure to select the compatibility patches, and it's all good. It works without issues because these mods either have a faux mod or respect the correct file structure that Mod Organizer can recognize automatically. But now, let's say that we have a mod that's not built correctly. It doesn't follow the right file structure. I'm copying it in my download folders as usual, I go to install it, and Mod Organizer tells me it's not valid. It probably means that the file structure is not good. So first we can remove it from our downloads folder, we're gonna extract the mod and see what's up. Let's take a look at a mod that's built correctly. If you open the archive, you can see that you have the mod folder and right after you have the game data. That's what we want. If we go to our anomaly install folder, for example, you can see that you have the game folder and right after there is all the important stuff, like the game data folder. That's the same structure we want for the mod. So if we go in our shitty mod, we can see that after the main folder, instead of game data or bin or tools or another important folder, there's another extra folder that's confusing Mod Organizer. So here, we're gonna go to our mod organizer folder, then the mods folder, and we're gonna copy the files directly into it, removing the extra step. Game data is here, we go one step back and we copy this folder directly. Same thing for this compatibility patch, they put in another layer of folders for some reason. Game data is here, we go one step back and we copy the folder directly in mods. Then you go back to Mod Organizer, you press F5 to refresh, and bim, we have everything working now. There is actually an easier way to do this. If we go back to when we do the regular installation and Mod Organizer gave us an error, you just have to go find the game data folder or DB tools, whatever main folder where anomaly storage data, and just drag it back to the main folder. This step is easier and faster, but I wanted to show you the manual process so you understand how it works, as it can help a lot in some situations. A lot of mods require, or at least are greatly improved by mod configuration menu. It's something you should always have installed when you mod Anomaly. Let's install it, and then let's install Jabber Souls-like, for example, an amazing add-on I talked about recently. When we launch our game, we can see that the mod configuration added a new menu in-game where you're gonna be able to see and tweak the settings of all the mods that you installed that are compatible. It's super useful to really tailor your game experience to your liking. And here we reach the end of my knowledge. If you have conflicts between mods, you can play with their priority order to see if it helps. Sometimes the conflict page can give you an idea of what's causing issues. Generally, the mod description will always tell you very clearly if it conflicts with other mods and what you have to do to fix it, being changing the load order, compatibility patches, and so on. The step after that is merging files that cause issue, but honestly, it's way above my pay grade, and I try to keep my modding of the game simple and straightforward. There's a reason why Gamma, EFP, and some other big mod packs are so popular. One big part is that they're taking care of making sure 200-300 mods work well together without any issues. Anyways, I hope this helps, and I'll see you in the next one. Cheers, guys.